It is believed that the first Cretan palaces were built soon after 2000 BC, in the early part of the Middle Minoan period, at Knossos and other sites including Malia, Phaistos, and Zakro. These palaces, which were to set the pattern of organization in Crete and Greece through the second millennium, were a sharp break from the Neolithic village system that had prevailed thus far. The building of the palaces implies greater wealth and a concentration of authority, both political and religious. It is suggested that they followed Eastern models such as those at Ugarit on the Syrian coast and Mari on the upper Euphrates. The early palaces were destroyed during Middle Minoan II, sometime before 1700 BC, almost certainly by earthquakes to which Crete is prone. By 1650 BC, they had been rebuilt on a grander scale in the period of the Second Palaces. 1650 BC, 1450 BC, marks the height of Minoan prosperity. All the palaces had large central courtyards which may have been used for public ceremonies and spectacles. Living quarters, storage rooms and administrative centers were positioned around the court, and there were also working quarters for skilled craftsmen. The Palace of Knossos was by far the largest, covering 3 acres with its main building alone and 5 acres when separate outbuildings are considered. It had a monumental staircase leading to state rooms on an upper floor. A ritual cult center was on the ground floor. The palace stores occupied 16 rooms, the main feature in these being the pithoi that were large storage jars up to 5 feet tall. They were mainly used for storage of oil, wool, wine, and grain. Smaller and more valuable objects were stored in lead-lined cists. The palace had bathrooms, toilets, and a drainage system. A theater was found at Knossos that would have held 400 spectators. An earlier one has been found at Phaistos. The orchestral area was rectangular, unlike later Athenian models, and they were probably used for religious dances. Building techniques at Knossos were typical. The foundations and lower course were stonework, with the whole built on a timber framework of beams and pillars. The main structure was built of large, unbaked bricks. The roof was flat with a thick layer of clay over brushwood. Internal rooms were brightened by light wells and columns of wood, many fluted, were used to lend both support and dignity. The chambers and corridors were decorated with frescoes showing scenes from everyday life and scenes of processions. Warfare is conspicuously absent. The fashions of the time may be seen in depictions of women in various poses. They had elaborately dressed hair and wore long dresses with flounced skirts and puffed sleeves. Their bodices were tightly drawn and round their waists, and their breasts were exposed. The prosperity of Knossos was primarily based upon the development of native Cretan resources such as oil, wine, and wool. Another factor was the expansion of trade, evidenced by Minoan pottery found in Egypt, Syria, Anatolia, Rhodes, the Cyclades, Sicily, and mainland Greece. There seem to have been strong Minoan connections with Rhodes, Miletus, and Samos. Cretan influence may be seen in the earliest scripts found in Cyprus. The main market for Cretan wares was the Cyclades, where there was a demand for pottery, especially the stone vases. It is not known whether the islands were subject to Crete or just trading partners, but there certainly was strong Cretan influence. Around 1450 BC, the palaces at Malia, Phaistos, and Zakros were destroyed, leaving Knossos as the sole surviving palace on Crete. In this final period, Knossos seems to have been influenced or perhaps ruled by people from the mainland. Greek became the administrative language, and the material culture shows parallels with Mycenaean styles, for instance in the architecture of tombs and styles of pottery. Around 1350 BC, the palace was destroyed and not rebuilt. The building was ravaged by a fire which triggered the collapse of the upper stories. It is not known whether this final destruction was intentional or the result of a natural disaster such as an earthquake. While parts of the palace may have been used for later ceremonies and the town of Knossos saw a resurgence around 1200 BC, the building and its associated institutions were never restored. In Greek mythology, King Minos dwelt in a palace at Knossos. He had Daedalus construct a labyrinth, a very large maze, by some connected with the double-bladed axe, or labrys, in which to retain his son, the Minotaur. Daedalus also built a dancing floor for Queen Ariadne. The name Knossos was subsequently adopted by Arthur Evans. As far as is currently known, it was William Stillman, the American consul who published Kallikrino's discoveries, who, seeing the sign of the double axe on the massive walls partly uncovered by Kallikrino's, first associated the complex with the Labyrinth of Legend, calling the ruins Labyrinthine. Evans agreed with Stillman. The myth of the Minotaur tells that Theseus, a prince from Athens, whose father was an ancient Greek king named Aegis, the basis for the name of the Greek sea, the Aegean Sea, sailed to Crete, where he was forced to fight a terrible creature called the Minotaur. The Minotaur was a half-man, half-bull, and was kept in the labyrinth, a building like a maze, by King Minos, the ruler of Crete. The king's daughter, Ariadne, fell in love with Theseus. Before he entered the labyrinth to fight the Minotaur, Ariadne gave him a ball of thread which he unwound as he went into the labyrinth so that he could find his way back by following it. Theseus killed the Minotaur, and then he and Ariadne fled from Crete, escaping her angry father. As it turns out, there probably was an association of the word labyrinth, whatever its etymology, with ancient Crete. The sign of the double axe was used throughout the Mycenaean world as an apotropaic mark. Its presence on an object would prevent it from being killed. Axes were scratched on many of the stones of the palace. It appears in pottery decoration and is a motif of the shrine of the double axes at the palace, as well as of many shrines throughout Crete and the Aegean. And finally, it appears in Linear B on Knossos, which probably represents the Mycenaean Greek, Daburin Thiopotniai, to the mistress of the labyrinth, recording the distribution of one jar of honey. A credible theory uniting all the evidence has yet to be formulated. Knossos appears in other later legends and literature. Herodotus wrote that Minos, the legendary king of Knossos, established a thalassocracy, sea empire. Thucydides accepted the tradition and added that Minos cleared the sea of pirates, increased the flow of trade and colonized many Aegean islands. Other literature describes Rhadamanthus as the mythological lawgiver of Crete. Cleinias of Crete attributes to him the tradition of Cretan gymnasia and common meals in Book the First of Plato's Laws, and describes the logic of the custom as enabling a constant state of war readiness.